roll call. Private Adams.
Here, First Sergeant.
Private Clark.
Here, First Sergeant.
Private Davis.
Here, First Sergeant.
Staff Sergeant Anderson. Staff Sergeant George Anderson. Private Tucker. Private Jeff Tucker. Private Jeff Morgan Tucker.
History is the study of the past, and genealogy, the study of families. Together, they are the study of being human and teach us the lessons of diversity, perspective, and change. Our cemeteries are an irreplaceable link, and taking care of them is a way to honor the legacy of those who came before us. I'm from the Collin County History Museum, and for the last 2 years, I have been there in the capacity of volunteer genealogist. I support the museum's mission of preserving local history by helping patrons research their own family history. And as of the beginning of the year, I have also been named as director of operations there. We are located in McKinney, just off the historic square, in what was the 1911 Federal Building. For the last 2 years, our previous exhibit commemorated the centennial of the U.S. involvement in World War I and the armistice. And my passion for genealogy turned toward researching the personal histories of our veterans, especially those who died serving our country in the Great War. It seems shocking to me that the records for our Collin County fallen patriots of World War I were not that well preserved. Honestly, we have very few pictures of them and not even a solid list of who they were. To be fair, it is somewhat difficult to be thorough. Some were born here but moved away or went to school here in Collin County or just registered for the draft here, settled here after the war, or are buried here because of family. But regardless of their connection to Collin County, we celebrate them as our heroes. Many of our World War I fallen heroes were very young men and did not have the chance to have wives or children of their own. So in a lot of cases, after their parents and siblings are gone, the records have been lost. It is a bit overwhelming, but frankly, there's not going to be a better time than right now to gather what we can find out about them and compile their records to honor their service. Today, I would like to celebrate Private Jeff Morgan Tucker. His story has affected me deeply and has led me on a course of research that I might not have otherwise had the opportunity to experience. There are at least 50 African-American soldiers from Collin County that served in World War I, but Private Tucker was the one among them who made the ultimate sacrifice in France serving our country. Jeff Morgan Tucker was born on December 4th, 1894, and grew up in the Louisville area of McKinney, which is just east of Highway 5. He and his siblings lived with their mother, Susie, near his grandmother, Phyllis. As you can see, he was called Morgan by his family, as is reflected here in the census. These are his brothers, Otto and Clarence. Actually, Morgan and his siblings are reported in the census in both his mother's home and again in their grandmother's home, so we can assume that they were very close. Unfortunately, by 1900, Otto Tucker had died before Morgan was even 5 years old. The 1900 census shows Susie as a widow working as a washwoman with only 6 surviving of her 9 children. By 1910, Morgan was 15, and the census shows that he was in school and could read and write. Again, you can see his brother Otto, and now there is a half-brother, June Timmons. When the United States formally entered World War I on April 7, 1917, Morgan was now 22 years old, living on his own in Dallas, working as a porter. As required, he registered for the draft that year on June 5th, 1917, along with everyone else his age. Notice his beautiful handwriting. He was called up and enlisted a year later on July 30th, 1918, and trained at Camp MacArthur in Waco for about 2.5 months. On October 13th, 1918, Private Tucker shipped out to France on the cargo liner Talthybius with Company I of the 816th Pioneer Infantry, which was an African-American regiment. You can see that his mother, Susie, had remarried and was now living in Greenville. This is the 1911 ship Talthybius. Of the 1,800 total passengers of that voyage, just under 1,000 were African-American Pioneer Infantry companies. There are no known photographs of Private Tucker. However, I found a series of candid photos of the men of his company at the World War I Museum in Kansas City. There are so many things I love about these: the 48-star flag, the trench whistle chains, the bugle, and if you look real close, the signet pinky rings that many of them wore. Unfortunately, the men in these photographs are not identified, but I like to think that one of these men may even be Private Tucker. We will never know. I was so taken with these pictures that I created an event at the museum called the Historical Paintout. We invite artists to come and be inspired by the details of history. At last year's paintout, one of our local artists, Rachel Rattan, created a sculpture of Private Tucker based on a composite of the men that we saw previously and the live model. The statue was stunning and beautiful, down to the details even in his shoelaces. I love his natural and peaceful posture. He holds a bugle in one hand and the American flag in the other. By the way, this year's paintout will be held March 23rd, is free, and you are all welcome. Private Tucker was a private in the Pioneer Infantry. The Pioneer Infantry would be the first into the area to ready the way for our battalions, clearing safe passage and constructing roads and bridges. They performed an important service that contributed to the success of American units and led to the eventual armistice. Similarly, after the armistice of November 11, 1918, about 3 weeks after Private Tucker arrived in France, there was still a tremendous amount of work to be done to exit the war. Performing the most somber of duties, thousands of pioneer infantrymen of the 813th, 815th, and 816th helped to collect bodies and body parts from the battlefields of France before the coming of winter. The men of the Pioneer Infantry made sure that all of our fallen soldiers received an honorable burial. I can think of no greater or difficult service. During this process, and about a month after the armistice, Private Tucker died of pneumonia on December 19, 1918. I should note that more than half of our World War I casualties were flu-related. In fact, the influenza pandemic of 1918-1919 caused between 20 and 40 million deaths worldwide. An estimated 675,000 Americans died of influenza during those years, which is approximately 6 times the number of American casualties of World War I. As it turned out, Private Jeff Morgan Tucker joined the very men he helped to bury with honor in France. His commander, Captain James Simpson, also died and is buried with his men to this day in the St. Mihiel American Cemetery, where the honored dead remain together, regardless of rank or ethnicity, as a band of brothers. At the request of his family, Private Tucker's body was eventually returned to McKinney in July of 1921. His funeral was attended by numerous family members, and he was reinterred at Ross Cemetery. It is unclear how or if his grave was marked at the time, but I was shocked to find out that his grave, the grave of a fallen war hero, was currently unmarked and on the verge of being lost to history. The story of Ross Cemetery is quite inspirational. I ran a search through our newspapers and found out that in 1952, the Ross Cemetery Association was reorganized and met at various local churches. They acquired the third and final acreage that was added to the cemetery and held chili suppers, pie fundraisers, benefit concerts, and took pledges to help make improvements and take care of the cemetery. Unfortunately, years later, Ross Cemetery was again in need of consistent maintenance. It's not that unusual for cemeteries to be left behind, unfortunately. People move away or just move on. In fact, there's a lot of cemeteries in Collin County that could use some love. As of just a couple of years ago at Ross Cemetery, the grass was thick and high again, and the fence had been compromised. But it's not like that anymore. Thanks to the tireless efforts of Miss Flo Henry, seen here, the current president of Ross Cemetery Association, and she is with Buffalo Soldier Paul Allen here, Ross Cemetery is looking as good as ever and truly beautiful. Ross Cemetery has been the current topic of several articles in our local newspapers. Authors Ken Byler and Garrett Cook brought much needed attention to the historic cemetery. A new fence was donated by Fortress Products. The Collin County Sheriff's Office facilitate community service to restore the landscape, and a group of veterans cleaned all the military graves by hand. The Daughters of the American Revolution began fundraising to honor Ross Cemetery on Wreaths Across America Day in conjunction with Arlington National Cemetery. I visited Ross Cemetery for the first time in the summer of 2017. Carson Doss and Miss Flo were making preparations for Veterans Day. It had been many years since a program had been held at Ross. Unfortunately, the list of veterans was incomplete. If there ever were written records for burials at Ross Cemetery, including the records for the veterans, they no longer exist. I decided the best course of action was a thorough inventory of Ross Cemetery. I drafted my family, my friends, plus a few high school honor society students and a local Girl Scout troop 2059 to help me. Over the course of a couple of weeks, we walked every inch of Ross Cemetery, which is about 7 acres, more than once, recording every grave marker. By the end of the project, we had counted 402 grave markers. I made sure that there were photos of all the markers as well and placed them online, or made sure that they already were posted online at findagrave.com, which is a collaborative online database for cemeteries so that they are searchable and accessible to everyone. We also added approximately 25 names to the veterans list at that point. So far, we have 74 verified veterans who are buried at Ross Cemetery. Unfortunately, we believe that there are more than 1,000 graves at Ross Cemetery, even though there are just over 400 markers. During our inventory, we were able to uncover several graves that were grave markers that were covered by a layer of soil, and perhaps there are many more throughout the cemetery just below the surface. Despite our best efforts, we still found no trace of any marker for Private Tucker. So, almost a century after his death, Private Tucker's grave was unmarked. Military grave markers are free to veterans, provided that all the criteria is met. You need to have military service documents, which I had. By the way, most military service records are available on familysearch.org, which is free. I also needed to prove that he was buried at Ross Cemetery, which I could do with his obituary. The challenge was that I needed a signature from Private Tucker's next of kin. Using genealogy skills, I was able to trace the families of Private Tucker's siblings to find his grandchildren, and great-grandchildren of his siblings. While the online privacy protections that are in place serve an important purpose, it also makes finding living descendants very difficult. However, through current obituaries, social media, and contacting other Ancestry.com researchers, I was able to find living descendants for two of his brothers, Otto Tucker and June Timmons. I'm particularly grateful to Michael Timmons, who is June Timmons' great-grandson, who did a great job putting together his family tree and posting it online. Private Tucker's grave marker arrived a week before Veterans Day, 2017, and Michael and his young family were there, all the way from the Washington, D.C. area where they live to place the headstone. And it was an incredible moment. The earliest veteran grave at Ross Cemetery, and one of the most celebrated, is that of Buffalo soldier Walter Faulkner. Walter Faulkner was born in Collin County in 1883 to John Lewis Faulkner and Maggie Crooms, who married as young teenagers. Both of Walter's parents were born in Texas, as were his grandparents. They were established here, and Walter grew up in the Lewisville area of McKinney. That's the same neighborhood as Private Tucker, who Private Tucker was just 11 years younger. The best I can tell, there were 11 siblings, and Walter was the oldest. By 17 years old, Walter was working as a waiter. In 1905, he was 23 years old and enlisted with Company D of the 9th Cavalry at Guthrie, Oklahoma. Citing his most current occupation as laborer, he was 5'7 and 3/4 inches tall. Along with the 9th Cavalry, he performed occupational peacekeeping duty at Camp McGrath in the Philippines following the Philippine War, in addition to hunting rebels. He completed his service and was discharged 3 years later at Angel Island, California in 1908. In January of 1910, he re-enlisted at Fort Logan, Colorado, this time assigned to Company G of the 9th Cavalry. He died that same year at Fort D.A. Russell in Laramie, Wyoming, on October 29, 1910. Just prior to his death, there is a record of the 9th Cavalry performing in an exhibition at the Wyoming State Fair. Even then, there was a fascination with the Buffalo soldiers, certainly something to be very proud of. Walter's body was returned to McKinney, where he was buried in Ross Cemetery. The following year, his mother applied for his military headstone, and it was installed. There are at least three of his younger brothers buried at Ross, all currently unmarked. Two died young in 1918, one in the flu pandemic. There are also two other Faulkner headstones besides Walter's at Ross right now, and they belong to the wife and daughter of his youngest brother. There are also probably many others from his family buried at Ross Cemetery. There are still 10 veterans at Ross Cemetery who have unmarked graves. And my wonderful group of honor student volunteers who helped with the Ross inventory have spent many an evening with me at the museum to try to find documents and next of kin so that we can apply for military grave markers for all who qualify. We call this the Remembrance Project. It is also my hope that we can collect photographs of our Collin County veterans, particularly the rare images of our World War I veterans. As this is my only platform to give recognition, I'd like to mention them by name. Johnny, Brendan, Chris, Jim, Jack, and James are my volunteers seen here. And these boys happen to be seniors. If by chance you're a member of a civic organization that recognizes young people who have contributed to the community, let me recommend these boys. You'd be hard-pressed to find a more civic-minded and dedicated group. One of the men that the boys and I have been working on is Dennis Collins. He was born on January 8, 1894 in Marshall, Texas. His father was Walter Collins and his mother was Virginia Wiseman, and there were many siblings. He registered for the draft in 1918 and stated that he was married. His wife's name was Gertrude and they had an infant son named Fitzhugh. Dennis was inducted on May 31, 1918, and served in the 165th Depot Brigade. He returned on an infirmary ship and was discharged a short time later on July 19, 1919, with a SCD, a service-connected disability. It appears that he had shell shock, which is what we now call PTSD. PTSD is, to this day, difficult to quantify, much less treat. You can see that they gave a disability percentage here of 18 3/4%. He returned home to his wife, and they had two more children pretty quickly, a daughter, Bernice, and another son, Roscoe, by 1920. He died of insanity in 1926, and he is buried in Ross Cemetery. We will do all we can to get a marker for his grave. His next of kin is hard to trace. It seems that every generation had some amount of tragedy, and they died young. I don't believe that he has any living descendants. I am in contact with a great-grandniece in California who is elderly, and we're working on it. Ross Cemetery, which is adjacent to the historic Pecan Grove Cemetery on Highway 5, is a historically black cemetery. In June of 1895, the original acreage was purchased for $105 and recorded as the Colored People's Cemetery. Shortly thereafter, it was renamed Ross Cemetery, possibly in honor of Hannah Ross, whose marker you see here, whose estate may have funded an additional land purchase. In addition to Ross Cemetery, there are four other notable historically black cemeteries in Collin County. The Old Plano City Cemetery of the Douglas community, the Houston Cemetery in Farmersville, the St. Paul Cemetery in Melissa, and the Salina Community Cemetery. Combined total, we know of approximately 50 black World War I soldiers who are buried in Collin County. At the museum, we only know of two photos of our African-American Collin County World War I soldiers in uniform. I give you Lonnie Lee Davis, cook of Company A, 24th Infantry. He is the father of esteemed McKinney educator, Miss Iola Malvern, who has an elementary school named for her. And this is Doughboy John L. Jones that Tom mentioned earlier. So why were our AEF, American Expeditionary Forces, in other words, American World War I soldiers who served overseas, called doughboys? Suffice to say that it probably did not start out as a compliment, but it has become a tongue-in-cheek term of endearment. There is a joke explanation for the origin, that the doughboys were needed in 1914, but didn't rise until 1917. 1914 is when the war started, and 1917 is when America entered the war. And the armistice followed shortly thereafter. I would like to share with you some beautiful images of World War I era African Americans who joined and served out of a sense of duty and were honored in their communities, who followed their accomplishments in the newspapers and newsreels. One thing to notice here is their overseas caps. At first, the men did not like the new, flimsy woolen caps until they found out that only those who went overseas were issued them. Then, of course, they became very popular. Also, soldiers were allowed to individually style them as they wished. You can see them cocked to one side or pulled way down over one eye. They would even put a few stitches in the top so that they would lay just so. By 1940, they were authorized. The overseas caps were renamed because now they were authorized for official use here on American soil. This is the YMCA mail facility at Camp Travis. Here you see them training with gas masks and marching. There's a lot of marching. This is a motorcycle messenger. They would carry messages from headquarters to the front and from front to front at high speed in the dark with war raging all around them. That's pretty amazing. And these are the Harlem Hellfighters that we've talked about, one of the most decorated African-American infantry regiments. These are nurses training at the Tuskegee Institute. Girls promoting the YWCA. And he makes the presentation because he has a really cute puppy. These are soldiers relaxing at the YMCA tent overseas. These pictures are of the 816th Pioneer Infantry, Company D, and were on the same roll as the pictures of Private Tucker's Company I, So they must have been in close proximity to each other. There's big need for nurses. Unfortunately, for war is not as compartmentalized as we'd like it to be. I love this picture of the sailors in their crisp whites reading with the flags in the background. The women of the Red Cross. The Harlem Hellfighters triumphantly returning home. And there were many parades to celebrate. In closing, my veteran projects are ongoing. I am slow, but careful, and we are continually making progress. My research on Collin County veterans and Ross Cemetery is available upon request at the museum. They contain newspaper articles, obituaries, various military documents, death certificates, and biographical information. We have a new exhibit opening February 28th. We are open Thursday, Friday, and Saturday, 10 to 4, and we are always free. Our new exhibits will be about old McKinney and McKinney as it is today. At the Collin County History Museum, we're also interested in your research, questions, and artifacts, and have a wonderful library and helpful volunteers. We love history mysteries, and we invite you to collaborate with us. And please, whenever you get the chance, be sure to say the names of our deceased servicemen's records and their names aloud to keep their memory alive. Thank you for having me. I appreciate being here. And we appreciate Tom Keener for being such a good friend to Ross Cemetery. Thank you.
Questions, Kristin, and by the way, she's such an incredible historian and genealogist. If you're stuck on a great aunt, she can probably trying to get the daughter and the mother of the person, she'll tell you how to find them. Questions, and isn't that fascinating how she was able to find, was it the great-grandchild of Private Tucker's brother? Backwards? And then forwards. That's what she did, because they won't. The military won't give the records unless a family member applies. Even if it's way down the line, if that's all you have, she was in Virginia,
Washington D.C.
Well, close, and that's not next door. Any questions, comments, protests? Come on, have some question, please. That's right, you covered everything. Any question of Ross Cemetery? Any question of the Doughboy soldiers? Any question of Private Tucker? I do know that we lost about 3 soldiers in Allen in World War I, and all of them were flu related. They contracted, they always said pneumonia, but or flu, it could be either one, they don't know, but it doesn't matter. They were doing their duty for their country and died in action. Questions? It's like, oh, finally, now we got 2 questions. Okay, good. All these bashful people.
The Ross Cemetery, is that encompassed within the Pecan Grove, or is it? Adjacent.
Take the microphone to you. Can you go on stage? And then say the answer so the television audience will hear it.
He asked me if Ross Cemetery was part of Pecan Grove. Actually, they're adjacent to each other. Pecan Grove is on the opposite. Where you would enter Pecan Grove, you go to the other side of it. The properties are adjacent, but they are separate entities and there are fences around both separately.
Carson Doss?
And I may have missed you, Kristin. You told how you found the individual, his family, mm-hmm. but I missed, how did you find the actual grave point where he was buried. How did you find that?
We have no way of knowing that. We know that he is within Ross. And then because Ross is relatively full, we had to get permission. We had to find family who would give us permission to put his marker on their plot. And the way that the marker, we did a flat marker so that it didn't have to disturb the ground, and it can be moved. If we ever found the exact location of where he's buried, it can be moved. There is an auto tucker. Michael Timmons allowed us to put the marker in his family plot, and it's right next to the Buffalo Soldiers headstone. But there is an auto tucker that is further out in the field, and I have worked and worked to try to connect, and I cannot say for certain if that is his dad or not, but I suspect. And there are two people on that marker, Otto, and a person that I cannot connect to, though I tried. But anyway, it's always in the back of my head that he's probably out there. And if we ever found out, easily remedied.
I just wanted to ask if you would repeat the name of the website that you gave, that you could start to research military family members.
Oh, yes. I recommend familysearch.org, a free website. I believe it's connected to the Latter-day Saints Church, but they have the service records better than, say, Ancestry, which is a subscription site. But I highly recommend familysearch.org. And then also a little hint, when you get into a records in an online genealogy site, try to click the original heading where it says, it'll give you the name. I don't know if you noticed on some of my documents, I left the heading where it talked about the name of the document, that it's the heading for all of the documents. If you click on that, then you can search that a little more thoroughly, then try again. So if you don't find, just keep looking, and sometimes it comes.
Who are you looking for?
Well, I just wanted to see if I could find some information about my dad's relatives. I know my dad was in the service. All right, which one? It would have been, he would be 90 now, so whatever. During the time,
Korea, World War II,
to 21.
Mm-hmm. Probably World War II.
Okay.
I would recommend to you also, I'm not, Tom, maybe you would know this about the Allen Library. I've spent a lot of hours at the McKinney Library. Ancestry is free within the library, so if you can search Ancestry, which is a subscription site if you do it at home, but at the library, there's a library edition, and you can search Ancestry in the library.
I also want to plug for the library in Plano.
Mm-hmm.
Is it Davis? Haggard. The Haggard Library in Plano has fabulous genealogy.
Excellent. And there is also the an archive in Fort Worth, and the Dallas, big in downtown Dallas, fabulous staff there. They will help you research, point you in the right direction of how you can research your family.
And the reason I couldn't tell you which one he was in is because I didn't really know that much about him. I just knew he was in the service. I've seen pictures.
Another thing that I would recommend to you is within Ancestry, again, free at the library, you can do a search. It is a separate search, but in the search category, you can search for other researchers doing research on the same person. So if Michael Timmons had not posted his family, I would have never been able to connect to them and find Private Tucker's family in the more recent generations. So that's a really great thing, is to collaborate with other researchers. Why do it twice? You know, if they've got it, you know. Now, I will say this, verify everything you find, but once you know where to look, it's a lot easier. And keep those records, keep a paper copy. It's easy.
And you'll be surprised what you find.
Yeah.
You might find something that, that's okay too. I have found some things I didn't want to know about people, but I mean, it still was a good story.
It makes us interesting, absolutely. It makes us human too, you know. We're connected to history, yeah.
Carson has another comment.
Sir, I'm just curious. Are you familiar with Paul Allen?
Yes, sir.
Okay, a dynamite individual. Hopefully you know him and you guys work together. You have the same interests and the same passions.
Well, they're good friends.
Good.
Believe it or not, I was trying to find my grandfather from World War II. And all we had was pictures. We didn't know what unit he was in or anything. But when I joined the military, I found out a lot of things about the military. It's a form called SF-180. And I submitted that form for my grandfather, and believe it or not, I got his entire record. They reissued all his awards. They reissued his military record. I found out where he was stationed, what ship he went over on. I got his draft card and everything just by submitting that form, SF-180. And come to find out, because I knew my grandfather, I was born in 1957, he died in 67, so I know him for a little bit, but he never talked about the war, but we know because he always wore his cap when he came back. And then I found out my grandfather had 3 Purple Hearts, because you know, back then, you know, if you got hurt, it was no dust off or no mask, you know, you stayed with the unit until they could drop you off somewhere. He had a Bronze Star and a Silver Star. So you can get a lot of information and stuff, and it's that SF-180 is free. And I did it on my grandfather's, my uncle's, and everyone and stuff. It's a good resource that you can use. Yes, you, what you do is.
I wanted to know if you could do that online.
What you do, you Google the form, the SF-180, then you print the form. And you filled it out, and if it's Navy, it tells you where to mail it to. If it's Army, it tells you where to mail it to. But be patient, because in this division, there's only 2 ladies where they very nice lady, but it takes them a little bit of time. And I got my grandfather's information back in 6 months.
Yes.
What was your father's name?
Felix Rather.
The reason I say that, I want everybody to repeat your veterans' names, your uncles, your grandfathers, your fathers, yourself, keep your children, say their names. Mm-hmm. Because like you said, what was the first, when they stopped breathing, and what was the rest of it?
You die twice, once when you stop breathing, and the second time when someone says your name for the very last time.
So, say it again.
Mm-hmm.
Any other questions, comments, protests? And always, when you given your best shot, Dallas Public Library, Haggard, and always Kristin. I want to tell you something. Isn't it wonderful what she's done for these graves up in McKinney?
Thank you. It's a group effort, to be sure.